Welcome to Hail Varsity Radio, the voice of Husker Nation. Insight, opinion, expertise, with the biggest and best names talking Nebraska across the state. Join the show on Twitter at Hail Varsity and at Schmitz underscore radio. Call in at 402-466-ESPN or 1-800-825-5865. Here's Chris Schmitz.
Happy holidays and welcome to it, Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition. I'm Damon Barr. We're presented by the Nebraska Lottery, and we are going to kick things right off on this Best of Edition. We are going to go to longtime Husker assistant coach Rick Kaczenski talking about tough coaching and tough love.
Let's get caught up with former Nebraska assistant Rick Kaczenski with this. Kaz, have you traded the turkey in for a Santa hat? How are you? Welcome to December.
Not ready for the Santa hat yet, brother. Not ready, man. So, just still winding down, starting to get the tree up. Got one of those pre-lit trees, and of course, when you put it up, none of the lights come on. So that's our battle right now. So, I guess it's better than trying to figure out how to stop Alabama, right?
Right. Yeah. So, there you go.
Could always be worse.
Well, hey, you have a month looking forward to watching Christmas Vacation and getting those lights to work, right?
Yeah, there we go, man. Yeah, so my wife's pretty good at that stuff. I'm good at buying things, and she's pretty good at decorating. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of her gig, her and the kids' gig. So I just come home from the Home Depot with with big boxes and let them unpack it. So,
well, if you need
I'm the bank. You know how that goes.
Well, if you need a couple extra trees that aren't, you know, show worthy, there's two in storage at our house because Lord knows we need three trees, you know. So tell me about what you saw with Nebraska, Iowa, and kind of get into, as we've deemed it here, Clapgate. What were your impressions of the game? Another tight ball game. Nebraska didn't win. Iowa, they're really good at winning close games.
Yeah, just, you know, kind of starting with the positives, and bear with me. I was watching it on a phone. I was at the Notre Dame North Carolina game, and on the drive up to Chapel Hill. So I had it on my center console in my truck. So me and my son Victor were watching it. So, I missed a few of the details. But, I like the way Nebraska came out. I thought they played real aggressive. I liked how the defensive line, I thought they were coming across the line of scrimmage, played real physical, and they were getting off blocks. So, obviously, I think Iowa had 129 yards rushing. So, you knew what Iowa was going to try to do, and Iowa wasn't able to do that and still won the game. And, you know, when you get to the close games, that's Iowa didn't beat themselves, and Nebraska just did too many things to keep Iowa in the game, give Iowa a short field, and you just can't give a good football team too many chances. So, and I think that's what they did, you know, the muff punt, the snaps, all those type of things, Schmitty. So, I mean, it really came down to November Big Ten football. That the team who made the least amount of mistakes wins the football game. You know, I think in the SEC and these other conferences, you talk about who's the more physical team. I can tell you, I was at that Notre Dame game Saturday or our Friday. Notre Dame was the more physical football team, right? Both teams were physical, Iowa and Nebraska. So it didn't come down to who was the more physical football team on Friday. It was who was going to make the least amount of mistakes. And unfortunately for Nebraska, that was Iowa again.
Rick, kind of reset your story with the center position. I know you played it, but you also moved to it. Was that a hard sell for you in your career? You were really talented out of the Notre Dame, but you didn't start out as a center.
No, I went there. Shmi, I was about 212 pounds my senior year of high school, and I used to get split out, play a lot of tight end, outside backer. So that's where folks recruited me as. I got to Notre Dame, I played tight end, was redshirted like it used to be back in the day. Mm-hmm. You know, I came in planning on redshirting and getting strong and big and all those type of things. So, played tight end and then got moved to fullback in the spring some, and that wasn't for me. I was a really I was a bad fullback, Schmitty. So I give those guys credit, especially those Nebraska guys, and just amazing. I embraced, I enjoyed the contact. I just I wasn't real good in space when guys moved on me. So in a telephone booth I could block you, but when you moved in space on me, it was hard. So I went back to tight end, and then I went back to center. So it was just a matter at that point. I wanted to get on the field. Right? I came in with a really good recruiting class. The guys I came in with, the guys I was, they were playing. So I, at that point, Schmitty, I just wanted to get on the field. Fortunately for me, unfortunately for a few other guys, we had some guys get hurt. And Coach Holtz and Coach Moore really didn't have a choice. So we had about four tight ends that were in the mix. I was playing about 10, 15 snaps a game, and I wanted to start. I wanted to play the whole game. And they asked which one of us out of – there was three that were asked to move, and I put my hand up. And I remember Joe Moore wrote on his board, and he said, "You're going to be a three-year starter if you listen to me." So – and that was kind of the transition, and I was very, very fortunate that I was surrounded by great football players with a lot of experience. So that really helped the transition. But I mean, once I was in there, there was no way you're getting me out. And in this day and age, with the transfer portal and all those type of things, Schmitty, it's, you know, when I was coming up, I was hoping they wouldn't ask me to leave. Mm-hmm. Right? That was the mentality. I was hoping to get on the field, and I knew it was up to me, not the coaches. It was up to me. I controlled my destiny once I got on to campus at Notre Dame. It was up to me, not the coaches. So you know, unfortunately, that's what we're dealing with this transfer portal and college football these days. So wasn't a hard transition for me, but I was surrounded by some great coaches and some great players that made that easier for me, Schmitty.
Rick Kaczenski is with us, Hail Varsity Radio. I look at what Nebraska's done with Juergens, really explosive athlete, super talented, very physical, but just not throwing strikes all the time. And he's a good kid. I mean, he's going to work on it. And Nebraska stuck with them, and there weren't problems in the second half with it. That said, you know firsthand the difficulty of playing the position. You also know that you got a job to do, right? So that dynamic. But it's, I mean, you've coached defensive line. You've kind of laid out the positions you know, and you've played in your career. How does center stack up to that from a difficulty standpoint between the mental side, and then you got to be one of those road graders up front too?
Yeah, I think when you look at the history of the schools, you know, you look at the pipeline, mm-hmm. you look at the Notre Dames of the world, the Ohio States, the Penn States, the Oklahoma, when they used to try to run the ball mm-hmm. on people. When you look at these great teams, Alabama, going back to Dwight Stevenson,
sure.
way back, you know, when you look at those guys, you have the athletic centers, guys that can get to the second level. But also, not only were they athletic, you're the quarterback for the line. You're making the calls. You're seeing the secondary. You know, at Notre Dame, they put a lot on us, rightfully so, man. You know, who was the double reader in the protection? We started at the safeties. We looked at the structure, all those things. So that, going back to the earlier question about the transition, that was the hard part, was you know, handling that mental aspect of it, where, you know, the responsibility is on me to get everybody going in the right direction. But you know what? If I made the call, I made the call with confidence, you know, everybody was on a string. You know, this is where we're going to. This is the mic. This is the free. This is the check. This is you're the double reader. So, you know, those things, that's big boy football, man. But, you know, Schmitty, the snaps and everything else that go along with it, I mean, that's part of the game. And when I look at Cam, you know, in that transition from tight end to center, it happened for him, you know, right away. You know, mm-hmm. I switched a couple different positions and all that. But Cam, he's explosive. He's athletic. He's smart. I mean, he played as a young kid. But I think, you know, there comes a point where, you know, this – it's a two-way street, right? Mm-hmm. He's got to figure out a way to get those snaps, and he will. He did it in the second half, right? But also, you know, the coaches got to help him. We were in shotgun at Notre Dame maybe less, probably about 10% of the time, maybe even less at that period in the 90s. So it wasn't a whole lot for me, but I didn't overthink it, right? But what my coach did, what Coach Holtz did, and what I did, I researched it because I had not only snapping with a guy underneath me, never snapped in a gun. So we researched it, and it just became automatic. And I just think right now he's just overthinking it. He didn't overthink it in the second half, and you saw the results. But he's too good of a player not to be on the field. He'll figure that thing out. And if I'm a betting man and if I'm hedging against Purdue this weekend, you're not going to see those errant snaps this weekend.
Couple more minutes. Rick Kaczynski's with us, Hail Varsity Radio. Kaz, I want to get into the transfer portal. You kind of intimated into it a little bit earlier in our conversation. And you have attrition, and every program does. And what is that process like as a coach coaching today's athlete? That some kids come in entitled, some kids come in with a lack of confidence. They want to play at this level, but some guys have some doubt. I mean, you have all different sorts of personalities, and it's never a cookie cutter. My question to you is, you know, how do you deal with guys that have a disagreement with the playing time they may or may not be getting, and also that re-recruitment side of things, keeping kids involved, engaged, and not running for home? Because if they're patient, which kids aren't, I get it, they could turn into really good players. And you see programs losing kids left and right.
Oh, this portal is just, oh, man. Unless the staff that recruited you leaves, mm-hmm. I just disagree with the portal. You know, life is hard, right? Mm-hmm. Marriage is hard. Working's hard. Business is hard. You know, college football, it's hard, but what's great about being a student athlete, just being a college student, is you learn how to handle adversity. And what I see, not just in college football these days, is you see a society that does not understand how to handle adversity. And when these players have an out, they take it. And, you know, you go back 25, 30 years, there's a lot more places to go. You know, there wasn't the UCFs, the USFs, mm-hmm. you know, Texas Tech, the Baylors, you know, guys weren't going to leave a Nebraska or a Notre Dame or a Penn State or a Michigan to go to these places. They were going to stick it out and drive through and deal with the adversity and graduate from the school that they committed to. It's just a different age. But I can tell you as a coach, man, I would struggle. Schmidt, you know, I'm a hard driving guy, and the guys that I coached that played for me, they appreciate that and they understood that. You know, it was never about me. It was about me trying to get these guys to see where I saw them beyond the limits that they put on themselves. And that's what every coach does. It's about pushing guys. I mean, it's just human nature. They're not a whole lot of fun about getting up and going to conditioning, you know, when you got a 35-mile-an-hour wind in January in Lincoln, Nebraska. You know, there's a whole lot of things that aren't fun about being a college football player. And, you know, you can't just turn and run the other way when things don't go your way. You've got to fight through those things. And I know it's hard, man. It's hard roster management. But those guys that leave that fast, you know what? They were going to fold on you at some point when you needed them. So that's the way I look at it. And, you know, the further away you get from home, the less you know about a guy. And, man, it's tough. I know with Nebraska, you got to recruit nationally. Mm-hmm. But, man, you know, those kids from Big Ten country, it just doesn't seem like they're as quick to leave as some other folks, mm-hmm. right? And I'll say that, and I don't say that about the Southeast or different parts of the country. I'm saying, you know, Clemson had a 5-star running back go back to Florida.
Right.
Kid from Florida committed to them. He took off, I think, back in September. If that kid's from South Carolina, he's not going back home. He's got a place to go, an equivalent program with a brand name that he can go to. That kid, if he was from South Carolina, he'd still be at Clemson. So, you know, I can't imagine dealing with it. But also, to me, there's no way in hell, Smitty, I was going to change the way I coach guys, right? There's no. I would have had to find guys just like I did at Iowa and just like I did at Nebraska that wanted to be coach. And I was honest and Bo was honest. This is how you're going to be coached. And this is why you're going to be coached this way. All right? Because I want you to be great. I don't care if you like me for these next 4 years. I care if you like me when you're 40 and you got three kids and you lose your job and you're facing adversity and you can reach out to me and we can help you and you're going to dig yourself out of that hole, right? Or when you sign that third contract for $40 million, right? Like that's when you're going to appreciate that coach that pushes you, right? That saw way more inside of you than you saw in yourself. And I tell you, those kids that just up and leave this quick, I mean, hey, I know there's all kind of reasons for kids leaving, man. But when you leave that fast, to me, that tells you a little bit about those guys. And I just think that there'll be a time they were going to fold on you anyway at some point when you needed them. And you got to worry about the guys that are on the roster. Don't worry about the ones that leave. Worry about the guys you got in that locker room and on that sideline, because that's all that matters right now, Schmitty.
And we're back.
Fellas, you think we could listen to the radio?
On Hail Varsity Radio, presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
Yes! That's awesome!
Welcome back to it, Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition. I'm Damon Barr, taking over today for Chris Schmidt. We got a great show lined up today. Sorry we couldn't get into it before. You just heard Rick Kaczenski talk, but we have Luke Gifford coming up this segment right before the draft. He, of course, went undrafted in 2019. He now plays linebacker for the Cowboys. Coming up after that, we have Husker signee Teddy Prochazka, 6'8 offensive lineman out of Elkhorn South. We will have two segments with Teddy P coming up. Next hour kicked off by the Pirate, Mike Leach, talking about signing day, talking about some of the stranger things that he's signed throughout his career. Then 5:25 hour, Brad Edwards talking college football playoff. Of course, now we know the teams. We'll hear some speculation. And at 5:40, who could forget a best of tradition, the annual Clausebourne Brandon Vogel Spelling Bee. You will not want to miss that. And then to cap off the show, remembering Bob Diaco, we're going to have our favorite Bob Diaco quotes coming up at the end of the show. But without further ado, here is Luke Gifford from 2019, right before the NFL draft.
We welcome back in standout Husker linebacker and has his sights set on the NFL. Luke Gifford back with us on Hail Varsity. Luke, how you been? Thanks for the time.
I'm good. Thanks for having me.
Well, what's it been like here the last week for you? Your travels. Tell us where you've been and what you've been up to.
Yeah, you know, it's been kind of crazy the last couple of weeks. I've been in Minneapolis and New Orleans, and I actually have another meeting tonight with Detroit. But I've probably talked to close to all 32 teams here in the last couple of weeks and throughout the whole process. So it's been really fun. We'll just have to wait and see what happens.
So the feedback to you from them has been what? They've obviously wanted to get with you because of your size and athleticism and versatility. But are you nervous when you go talk to an NFL team?
Yeah, you know, I think the first time it was a little nerve-wracking. You know, you see all these guys on TV and you know, you've heard of them growing up, and then you're sitting in their office meeting them and having conversations about football. And I mean, once you get in there and you start talking, it's nothing different, you know. But it is a little intimidating at first, and it took me a little bit to get used to, for sure.
Luke Gifford's joining us, Hail Varsity Radio, Husker linebacker, and set for what's next for him. And he's chatted with most of the NFL, which is really cool. Tell me about your training. How has that gone? And what have you been working on and trying to hone in on to get ready for that next workout, that next tryout, that next opportunity?
Yeah, it's been really good. You know, staying here and training in Lincoln was really beneficial for me. I've gotten a lot out of it. You know, just being able to use the weight room and the indoor facility down at the university has been huge. Our coaching staff has been really supportive. So that's been really nice, you know. And then the biggest thing for me, and especially linebackers in today's league, is, you know, everything's about speed now. So just being able to have fluid hips and turn and run with guys is huge. So I'm always working on my hips. And then just keep getting stronger. You can never be strong enough. So that's been the biggest thing for me. And then trying to learn new positions. I'm potentially going to have to play inside at the next level. You know, there's a lot of teams that see me outside or inside. So just learning those things. You know, I've met with Coach Shenander a couple times to pick up on the inside backers and some of the things that they do. So it's been a fun process.
Luke Gifford is joining us, Hail Varsity Radio. Luke, what's your reaction to that inside suggestion? I mean, I know you can do it. I know you're big enough to do it, but have you reached out to anybody about playing inside aside from Shenander? Have you picked Coach Rude's brain? Have you talked to any of your former teammates about that switch? Does it freak you out, or does it, you just kind of roll with it?
Yeah, it is different, but luckily I have a little bit of experience just from past staffs. You know, I didn't always play inside, but I got a little bit, got a little taste of it, so I kind of know what to expect. And I haven't talked to Coach Rude about it yet, but he's definitely someone that I want to hear before the draft, you know, and just kind of see what he has to say about it. But there's a lot of the same things. You know, it's all about reading your keys and having your eyes in the right place. And if you can do that, then the game kind of slows down for you. But yeah, it'll definitely be an adjustment if that's something that I have to do, which I'm assuming it probably will be at some point in time. But I think I'll be able to roll with it and pick it up pretty quickly.
Have you had any awkward discussions, as in brag about yourself, sell yourself? You've always been a pretty humble dude, but have you had to answer something and kind of pump yourself up, I guess, is my question, when in those meetings?
Yeah, for sure. And it's hard for me.
It is.
You know, there was one time, I don't remember who it was or what organization it was, but they said something like, well, you just seem really modest. I mean, I don't know, like, do you have a chip on your shoulder or anything? And I was like, well, yeah, if we want to start talking about that, I can get into it. But it's hard for me to talk about myself. So, I've learned that you really are selling yourself. You know, you got to push yourself to, you know, you don't want to be cocky, but just make sure that they know you're really confident in your abilities, and which I am, you know. So it's just, it's different. It's not like college where they're just recruiting you. You know, it's different. You got to sell yourself to them, and so it's a different aspect for sure.
Okay, so what is, if there is, that chip on your shoulder then? What mm-hmm. What do you use for motivation?
Well, you know, I think the biggest thing for me, you know, I think if I don't have those two injuries that I had in my time in Nebraska, then it's really not even a discussion whether or not I'm getting drafted, to be honest with you. And, you know, I hope I end up getting drafted on day three, but if I don't, then I'm still going to go about it the same way, you know. But everybody I've talked to, I've told, listen, I'm not a day three type player. You know, I have a lot left, and my best football is still to be played.
That's Luke Gifford, Hail Varsity Radio, Husker linebacker, and futures set on the NFL. Luke, a thought here on Nebraska. Is it going to be weird Saturday for you with the spring game and you're watching for the first time ever?
Yeah, it is going to be really weird. Never experienced tailgating or being outside the stadium the day of a game in, I mean, 5-6 years. So it will be weird. I'm looking forward to it, though. I'm ready. I'm excited for those guys, and it'll be fun to watch them.
So what's on the old menu if you're going to tailgate for the first time?
I'm not sure. I'm going to have to hit up some of my friends and see what they do on game days. I'm a newbie, so I'm sure they'll have a bunch of spots to take me and all that stuff, but I'm excited for it. It'll be fun.
Make sure that they are feeding you. You're not bringing, but you're just partaking, all right?
Yes, no doubt.
I want to go back to this team, and Coach Frost has been extremely upbeat. So is Chenander. Defense, it looks like, has gotten the better of the offense. I know the O-line's still trying to work some things out with center and guard. But, I mean, the defense has made strides and steps forward. And it feels like the culture that you guys kind of helped set is starting to take hold of accountability, and guys want to go play football versus, oh, man, we got to go to practice. Guys like Lamar Jackson are a voice in the locker room and a leader, and guys have grown up. The defensive line is taking steps forward as well. Is there a point last year where that culture changed for the better? I know it did, but can you pinpoint that positive tipping point?
You know, I think it kind of started after the Northwestern game. You know, people started kind of believe more, and then, but really when we went toe-to-toe with Ohio State, I think that's when the biggest jump happened. You know, we had started in the right direction, but then, you know, to go up there and go down to the wire with them and really probably should have pulled that game off, I think that showed people a lot, you know, that we were just heading in the right direction. And it's amazing, honestly, even to just go to practice. And, you know, there's still things we worked on and areas that guys got to develop and stuff. But it is just a completely different atmosphere, the way they practice and play. So it's been really fun to watch.
Luke, some thoughts on the outside backers. I know Caleb Tanner isn't playing, but Fergie's a senior. Mm-hmm. Alex Davis is a senior, and Alex is one of the guys that's been mentioned. And JoJo Doman as well. Touch on that core group of backers on the outside that are back, and what's impressed you about has any of those kids stood out to you?
Yeah, for sure. You know, Ferg is a good player, man. If he stays healthy, he'll have a really big year, I think. And then, you know, Alex, if Alex cuts loose and just plays, he can be a really good player too. And I've seen him do it. You know, he does it at times, and so for him, it's just kind of putting it all together and being consistent with it. But I think he's definitely made a big jump this spring. And then JoJo, I think JoJo's just a football player. He is always making plays. The majority of the time that there's a big play made in practice, it's probably something that guy did. So he is a heck of a player. So I'm really excited to watch him this season. And then, you know, like you said, there are young guys. Caleb's going to be a really good player here, I think. You know, it's obviously his injury kind of set him back a little bit, but I think he'll have a good summer and come into fall camp ready to roll.
With Doman, I mean, it's a similar path to you, and Luke Gifford's with us, because he was a safety in you know, at Nebraska, but they put him at the training table. He's at 230. Yep. Brickhouse is edited, but that's the term used by Coach DeWitt.
And he's right.
Right? But you also, I mean, you were a safety that converted to outside. I mean, about 90 seconds here. Was that easy? Was that difficult? You made it look easy.
Yeah, you know, it's a lot different, but there's also a lot of similarities, you know. A lot of times those safeties are playing similar roles when they're coming down into the box, you know. So I think JoJo kind of has started to understand that really he may be playing linebacker, but he still does a lot of things that he would have been doing playing safety. And he gets the blitz and do all that other fun stuff, you know. So he's someone that really, you know, he's starting to understand the defense, and he's starting to kind of toy with the way he lines and all that stuff. And as soon as he starts doing those things, look out, because he can make a lot of plays.
Luke Gifford, standout Husker with us, and he's looking towards the NFL. Luke, we'll get caught up with you again after the draft. Thanks so much.
Yes, sir. Thanks for having me.
Luke Gifford on a Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition. Quick note, nearly 70% of people in fatal crashes in Nebraska are not wearing a seatbelt. If used properly, a seatbelt can reduce the risk of fatal injury by up to 60%. Your best defense in any crash, buckle up. Message brought to you by the Nebraska Department of Highway Safety Office. Next up, Teddy Prochazka, offensive lineman, signee with the Huskers. We'll hear from him from signing day.
Chime in 402-466-ESPN or email the show, chris@hailvarsity.com.
Just try me.
Back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Welcome back to a Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition. Let's continue the show with Teddy Prochazka from Signing Day 2020.
Let's step in with a big-time get just up the road from Elkhorn South. Teddy Prochazka is with his offensive tackle. Teddy, what's the, I guess, the wait been like for you to finally sign on the dotted line today?
Well, you know, it's been a long time coming. This day I've been waiting, looking forward to it for months now, and now that it's actually here and I'm finally signed and officially a Husker, it's just like a weight's been lifted off my shoulders, and I'm just overly joyed.
Teddy Prochazka is with us on Hale Varsity Radio. Early signing day 2020 for the 2021 class. Now, Teddy, I want to kind of get into your recruitment for a moment. And yeah, Barrett Rood and Greg Austin were very key in helping you become a Husker. And I know you're a Nebraska guy, but was there ever a moment, or did you ever wonder, or was it always Nebraska for you? Kind of take us through your process and then ultimately what made you most comfortable.
Yeah, so when they first offered me, it was kind of a dream come true, just because growing up in Nebraska, that's like the dream of that every football player has is going to go play there. But, you know, I'm not going to lie. I was kind of open to other schools. If they wanted to, you know, offer me, or if they were interested in me, I'd go check them out. But as the process kind of went along, I found myself making more relations with the coaches at Nebraska than I was at other schools. I was making relationships with some of the players there and some of the other recruits that they had coming in. And so I just kind of felt more comfortable with that program. If I could do it all again, I'd do it any differently. And just in the end, it was just the coaching staff. I'm comfortable with them, the game day environment that they have, the fans. I mean, of course, this year it's not the same, but mm-hmm. I know that it's going to get to that eventually while I'm still there. And, I mean, there's really nothing more to it.
Teddy, with Coach Austin, your position coach, how was he able to connect with you? And, I mean, you know, as well as a lot of Nebraska kids, that Nebraska offensive line tradition, being an in-state kid, what is it about Coach Austin that you believe in? And then vice versa, what did he see in you? Obviously, your measurements are great. You play great football. But, again, it's a jump to a major Power 5 league.
Yeah, I mean, from the first day I met him, I knew that there was something special about him. He tells it how it is. If he, you know, has some criticism, he'll let you know, but he'll also let you know what you can do to improve on that. And I just felt like that openness that we had with each other. I mean, he was still recruiting me and wanted me to go there. But, I mean, he did it in a way that made me feel comfortable in knowing that he was going to be my coach and teacher for what was to come. Also, he saw my physicality. You know, obviously measurables play a big factor into it. But when you're my size, it's also about physicality and my ability to pull and block in the open space. And they've kind of, you know, let me know that that's how they want to use me, as guy to get out into space and make those blocks on linebackers. Or, you know, pass protection. He enjoys how I, you know, do my pass pro. And that's what he would just tell me throughout this season, last season, throughout the entire recruiting process.
Teddy, I want to ask you briefly about some of the other guys that are in your recruiting class. You got to play against one of them in the state championship game. That was Kobe Bretz. But which of those guys are you closest with? Which ones are you most excited to step on the field with?
I'd say I'm closest with Henry Litowski, Thomas Fedoni, Seth Malcolm, Heinrich, and those are like some of the guys that I've hung out with before. I'm close with AJ Rollins, James Carney, those in-state guys, Kobe. I'd say I'm most excited to step on the field with Henry, just because of how close we've become throughout this process. He was one of the first guys I told. That was one of the recruits from Nebraska that I was committing. You know, we're rooming together. I've seen his film. I know that he's going to do great things there. I just can't wait to play with him.
Teddy Prochazka with us a few more minutes. Signing day, December, the early signing session for the 2021 class. Teddy Prochazka is with us from Elkhorn South, signed to be a Husker this morning. So, Teddy, I mean, have the guys given you a nickname or anything? Are you the ambassador? You touched on the the chemistry you have with the guys. You were hosting a lot of watch parties. I mean, how many football games did you and some of the guys sit and watch together?
About two or three, but I mean, that's when they can make it up. No nicknames quite yet. We do have a group chat called Operation Teddy's House. So we text in that if we're planning on having all the guys left to come watch the game. But I bet the nicknames will come soon.
Operation Teddy's House. So give us an idea. I mean, you got linemen, you've got defensive backs, you've got skill guys. Yeah. What was the spread like? Let's talk food for a minute. We'll get into more football. But what was the spread like in the basement?
You know, we got to get the pizza. We catered runzas and, you know, wings, all the whole nine yards for giving it like a somewhat Nebraska game day feel when it comes to food.
Okay. Who put the most food away? Or did you kind of take that home because of being on the O-line, being as big as you are?
Yeah, I mean, I would say between me and Henry, we kind of clear house when it comes to eating food. If there's anything left over, we'd kind of just go through and pick it off.
Teddy, while we're on the topic of food, you got a pretty big frame, and I expect that you're probably going to be filling that out as you get to the University of Nebraska, putting away a lot of food. But what do these coaches have planned for you in terms of strength and conditioning, in terms of what type of body they want for you, and where they want you on the offensive line?
Well, I'm sitting at about 297 right now, just under like 300. They told me that they can get me playing healthy and still able to move at 325. I know that it's going to come gradually. I put weight on pretty easily. But lifting a lot of weights and eating a lot of food, I mean, that's kind of the game plan right now.
Teddy, when did you kind of hone in on football just in your life? When did it go, okay, this is a sport I really like most? You're pretty athletic.
Well, I mean, football has always been like a huge part of my life. I mean, flag football, through youth tackle football, through middle school, through high school. It didn't really sink in that this could be something that I could do at like a college level until I got that first offer. And when it happened, I mean, it kind of, that's when I realized, hey, I'm not really going to be focusing on any other sports, that this is the sport I'm going to play. I did play basketball still, but I mean, that was just kind of a side thing for me to stay in shape.
We will hear more from Teddy Prochazka in just a few moments. Offensive lineman out of Elkhorn South, signee for the 2021 Huskers class on a Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition. If you're just joining us, you missed out on Rick Kaczenski and Luke Gifford in the first hour. If you want to catch the show, the podcast will be up on Spotify, on iTunes, on Google Play, wherever you get your podcasts. Hail Varsity Radio, part of the Hurrdat Media family. Thank you to everyone over at Hurrdat and Hail Varsity for making this show happen. And we are also sponsored by the Nebraska Lottery. Coming up, we have Teddy Prochazka in the next hour. You don't want to miss it. Mike Leach. We have Brad Edwards. A spelling bee to remember. And a little bit of Bob Diaco. Teddy P up next.
And now, back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Welcome back to a Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition. We continue our talk with Teddy Prochazka on signing day.
What's your take on things right now, Teddy? Is you're going to enroll early and get there and bond with some of the current guys, and I'm sure you've been able to talk to guys that are on the team, but you know, just as coaches have said, the ups and downs, the inconsistency, they're working on turning a corner. What's your view on that, and what's a class goal? Have you guys talked about some of the things you want to do?
You know, yeah, the coaches have said it. It's inconsistency, shooting themselves in the foot. From my perspective, I can see the O-line looking a lot better and progressively looking better than what they used to look like. And I think that's just kind of the culture thing. You know, the coaching program, their coaching staff there kind of came in, and I felt like the culture was broken. But it's just kind of a rebuilding the culture. And they're close, you know, they're losing close games. I know that's going to turn around eventually. But with this class, I mean, yeah, thing I noticed most is there's a lot of guys that are prepared to work their asses off, you know, get in day one, hit the weight room, start start working, you know, learn the playbook, and wanted to make an impact as soon as possible just to turn that curve and start winning games that we need to win.
Teddy, I'll let you get out on this, and Teddy Prochazka is with us, Hail Varsity Radio. We hear a lot about culture, and we understand culture, but in your mind, what can you define a successful culture? What's that like in the locker room, peer to peer?
I'd say holding each other accountable. You know, if a player sees that one player was kind of slacking on certain drills or didn't have the best practice, is holding them accountable, making sure that they get that figured out, making sure that they're coming back 10 times harder the next time around at the next practice or next game or whatever it is, the next drill. And then eventually that's just going to translate to games. It's just everybody's holding each other accountable, you know, believing that they can win these games, working as hard as they can. I feel like that's winning culture.
Are you comfortable having that voice?
I mean, at the start, I'm going to have to grow into that.
Sure.
But eventually, yes, I'm definitely comfortable being that guy that holds people accountable, making sure they're doing the right thing.
Teddy Prochazka, Elkhorn South, and of course, part of Nebraska's 2021 class. Teddy, best of luck to you. We'll do this again. Thanks for a few minutes with Hail Varsity.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Teddy Prochazka on Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition on this Monday. If you're looking to make a move in 2021, give the real estate professionals at West Blue Realty a call today. Specializing in residential home sales in Lincoln and surrounding communities, they will help you make your next move a smooth one. For a limited time, mention Hail Varsity, and West Blue Realty will provide you with up to $1,000 upon the closing of your next home purchase. Call Tom Luby at 402-540-3768 or Kelly Hofschneider at 402-202-2312 for more details. It pays to work with West Blue. Visit them at westbluerealty.com or 1120 K Street, Suite 200 in Lincoln. You got to ask yourself, what can West Blue do for you? All right, we're moving on into hour two of this Hail Varsity Best of. We're going to start things off with a favorite, the Pirate himself, Mike Leach, from signing day also, talking about some of the strange things that he's signed over the years. After that, we have Brad Edwards to talk about the college football playoff, which team is the team to beat. It won't surprise you. And then the Clausebourne Vogel annual spelling bee. You're definitely not going to want to miss that at 5:40. And then we will sign off with Bob Diaco. Hail Varsity Radio, presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
Welcome to Hail Varsity Radio, the voice of Husker Nation. Insight, opinion, expertise, with the biggest and best names talking Nebraska across the state. Join the show on Twitter at Hail Varsity and at Schmitz_radio. Call in at 402-466-ESPN or 1-800-825-5865. Here's Chris Schmitz.
Welcome back to Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition. Here's the Pirate, Mike Leach.
Coach, you do?
Yeah, shoot, we're getting ready to go out to practice, get ready for another one here, you know?
Well, that's the way it is, and I got to ask you, how's it worked out for you? Mike Leach with us here on Hail Varsity Radio. You're down to slim and none when it comes to your scholarship numbers. How have you navigated that the last couple weeks? Got Auburn this weekend.
Yeah, we're gaining ground a little. We're still below the limit or whatever, but anyways, it is what it is. And then, you know, so it's kind of mixed. I mean, on one hand, you don't want to be shorthanded, but the other hand, you really don't want to miss the opportunity to play, you know?
Well, that's kind of the message here in Lincoln. Scott Frost and Nebraska have been very adamant all year, obviously, about playing ball. And it's not gone well some weekends. It's gone well other weekends, but it's about getting better, and you get better by playing. Has that been your message to your kids?
Yeah, that's totally been our message. And you know, the thing is with all the disruption, I mean, it's pretty difficult to consistently perform at the level you'd like. And of course, we're a very young team, so that was going to be an adventure anyway. But the thing is, you still want to get those reps in. I mean, there's a lot of good stuff happening out there, and we've got guys getting better and things like that, and you really want to continue that.
Coach, how do you stay patient with youth? You can see flashes, and this isn't your first rodeo building a program.
It's up and down. It's highs and lows. I mean, it's really exciting to see them improve, and then there'll be some bonehead thing that you look out there and you say, I can do that myself, which, you know, it's just, it's both extremes, very fulfilling and very frustrating.
I got to ask you, are you in a kitchen or a kind of a work slash break room? You got some rattling around going on.
Here's what's going on here. You'll like this.
It's a cowbell.
So I'm signing stuff, footballs and cowbells. And see, we're a big cowbell university. So I'm signing some cowbells, and they sound like this. We got a bunch of cowbells here, and so I'm signing some for the good folks of Mississippi State.
I like that. The cowbell, and I don't have just the instrumental to Don't Fear the Reaper, but, man, I wish I did, because you could play along.
We could for sure.
Mike Leach with us on Hail Varsity Radio. So I want to jump into the transfer portal with you on how that is to navigate in 2020. And if you put your college football czar hat on, would you have it as wide open as it is, or are you just dealing with it?
Just deal with it. I mean, just dealing with it. That's all you can do. I mean, the transfer, you wonder if you're going to have a transfer portal, maybe we ought to, as teams or coaches, you ought to be able to transfer some guys if they don't hold up their end, you know?
So cutting folks that aren't living up to expectations?
Yeah, I mean, guy says, hey, I want to go somewhere where I can play, or, you know, there's some guys, you know, sometimes a certain amount are just malcontent type of guys that you just missed on, you're just wrong about, and then the guy transfers, they want a different school, well, we might want a different player, you know?
What's that like for you when it comes to making contact with a kid? Obviously, you want to see him in person and evaluate. You can't do that in 2020. But just overall, honestly, through your experience.
Honestly, most of the players that we've had transfer are guys that are looking for an opportunity to play for the most part. Not all, for the most part. They're looking for a chance. They're down the depth chart. They just want a chance to play. And that's, I think that's more legitimate. There are some cut and run guys. There's no question about that. I think that, they're talking about some rule where everybody gets a free transfer for 1 year, doesn't have to sit. Well, then if they do that, then everybody will just strictly recruit off the transfer portal, you know?
Yeah.
I think they need to be careful with this. I mean, because, you know, when I was in college, hell, I wanted to cut and run a lot, you know. It's like, oh, this is hard. Yeah, it's hard. And then, there's a certain amount of growth and benefit to persevering and pushing through and the ability to do that is something that you learn. You're not just born with. And I think that, having to push through provides its own rewards. And I think that that's an important thing that we need to make sure doesn't get lost.
Few minutes, Mike Leach with us, Hail Varsity Radio, head coach, Mississippi State. Big showdown with Auburn this weekend, and coach right now is signing cowbells for all the Mississippi State fans. And I'm sure a few Husker fans would send a cowbell your way if they had one. I got to ask you, with the conversation, when it comes to a kid, have you had kids look in the eye and say, "Coach, here's my reason"? And then does the conversation stay positive? Do you get ticked off? Does the kid get an attitude? You've had all instances, I'm sure.
What the first part of the question, what did you say?
When it comes to the transfer part, do you have kids come tell you themselves, or is it just something you find out after the fact?
Both. Both. But they to go on the portal, they go through – they go to compliance. So you, even if they don't come to you, you hear from compliance that they're going to, you know. And some kids, I mean, it's all shapes and sizes. Sometimes the guy's just discouraged and you need to pep him up a little bit. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the guy's a bad attitude guy and he beat you to the portal before, you know, you were inclined to encourage him to move on. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's a guy down the depth chart that you really have kind of a lot of admiration for, you know, that tries hard, plays hard, does everything you ask him. He just wants an opportunity to play. And then at least in my case, I actively will call around and try to, you know, find some people to you know, that would be a good opportunity for him. And then some have just been guys that, I don't know, like a young guy just gets discouraged prematurely, and rather than stick it out, where, you know, odds are high he would have been successful if he kept pushing and kept trying. You know, he didn't give himself that opportunity. You know, goes on the transfer portal, and those type of guys, you'll see them on the portal again the following year. You know, some guys are perpetual portal guys, and I think that's a bad approach.
What's an instance? You said that there were times you wanted to cut and run. Who gave you the advice to stick it out? Obviously, you've had moments where you've had to persevere through things, but is there a moment you think back to, either undergrad, law school, coaching, whatever?
Well, you know, I went to college. I graduated in 8 semesters, which is a little quicker than I'd recommend. I should have smelled the roses more. about 17. I should have smelled the roses more, but, you know, I mean, it's all the same thing with everybody, if you think about it. It's really, generally speaking, it's the same with everybody. You know, you have a bad day, you feel sorry for yourself, you got all of a sudden, you know, a midterm, a paper, and 2 other papers, and then a surprise pop quiz, all the stuff. You know, you get overwhelmed with your academics, you start to feel sorry for yourself. You think, maybe I should do something else. Is it all worth it? You start to feel sorry for yourself. You know, 4 years of school, or in my case, if you go to law school, that's a long time. You know, you feel sorry for yourself. You just got to boost yourself up. And I found that just kind of trying to be around positive people, listening to positive people that have achieved things, I can draw my own encouragement out of that. Some of it was subtle. Some of it's just maybe a nice person or a stranger you met. Mm-hmm. Some of it were friends that I could confide in. Basically, they just listen and you get it off your chest. And just by articulating it, you create your own clarity to a situation. I can't say I was always right, mm-hmm. But I think that it definitely helped, and it offered me a chance to make the right decision a lot of times. I don't know. You just got to keep pushing. You got to keep showing up, and you know, all you can do every day is believe in yourself and do the best you can. And I think in the end, it'll take you quite far.
Mike Leach with us, Hail Varsity Radio. Coach, sitting in, getting ready for practice, signing cowbells. We could play Name That Tune, but I want to ask you what's the coolest or the most unique thing you've signed in your career? And I know there's a lot of books out there, Swing Your Sword, that have autographs.
I don't know about cool, but unique was, okay, so I was at a signing at Texas Tech, you know, and after the spring game, we would have autograph signed. Mm-hmm. Okay, and so there's a lady back there, an older lady, and she's a big older lady, and she comes up and, you know, kind of laughing and blushing, and she comes up and she holds up this bra.
Oh, wow.
And I mean, this bra, we're talking volleyball size, okay? I don't know what the letters of the alphabet would be, but...
Multiple Ds?
You know it's higher, volleyball, okay? and she's, you know, sort of embarrassedly laughing as she did it. And then you can see by her T-shirt that was the one that she wore to the game that day, okay? Because you can see that at some point it was pulled off.
Uh-huh.
And then behind her, or kind of her, and I'm assuming her adult kids,
because mm-hmm.
they're younger than her, but her adult kids, it's almost like mom lost a bet or something, or they dared her or something. And so they're back there just laughing, right? And she brings up the bra and says, "Would you sign this?" Well, I'm happy to sign nearly everything. And so, yep, sure enough, I signed a big bra.
So you got to sign a bra, but have you ever had to sign, or I shouldn't say have to, have you been asked to sign cleavage before?
I went at the top, kind of between the neck and the cleavage. I agreed to shoot high. Okay,
yeah, sure.
I did have a guy come up one time, and no, I mean, as long as he enjoys it, I guess it's a good thing. But he has me sign his arm.
Okay,
autograph his arm. Because he's planning as soon as it's, as soon as it's done, from there he's going to go get it tattooed on his arm.
Okay.
And I thought tattooing my signature to an arm, I wouldn't encourage anyone to. I would think very carefully about a move like that, but. Hopefully he's still satisfied with my signature tattooed to his arm.
Back to the aiming high portion of the interview between cleavage and neck, was the technique solid? Were you shaky or not?
No, not shaky at all. But I'm left-handed.
Okay.
So it's naturally kind of a shaky signature to begin with. Left-handers will relate to this because if it's going to smear, you're kind of screwed. You don't get to rest your hand down while you write like a righty does. Because a lefty, you rest your hand down and write, it's going to smear it,
gotcha.
You know?
Yes.
And so you try not to do that.
Well, Coach, keep signing those cowbells, and Merry Christmas to you and the family, and we'll do this again. Thanks for jumping on with us.
All right, absolutely. Always good to talk to you.
And now, back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Welcome back to a Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition. Here's Brad Edwards talking about the college football playoff and who he suspects to be the team to beat.
We welcome in Brad Edwards, ESPN Insider College Game Day. And Brad, interesting day. I want to start with this, though. It kind of hits a little bit close to home. with some Nebraska fans. Word from different sources, Bo Pelini not expected to return at LSU. What's your reaction to that? If there's an announcement a little bit later, let's say it's true, one and done for Bo, does that surprise you?
Well, it would have surprised me before the season started, but when you look at everything that went wrong for LSU as the season went on, you know, and it got worse and worse, there were some bright spots offensively toward the end. You know, they had a freshman quarterback who played pretty well in the last couple of games, and even without a whole lot of receivers, they still were putting up some points, but their defense still couldn't stop anyone. And look, I mean, there's no question it wasn't as talented of a defense as they had last year, and Coach O did himself no favors by declaring over the summer that the unit was looking better than it did at any point last season. So, you know, where was there a miscalculation on his part? I mean, certainly he deserves a lot of the blame for this. He made the hire. He's the one who hyped the defense before a game had been played. But ultimately, it's Pelini's scheme. He was in charge, and it was an absolute disaster for a team that really, over the last decade plus, has been one of the most consistent defenses in college football. And so, you know, something had to pay. Something, someone, whatever. Mm-hmm. There had to be a hit taken for what happened this year. It wasn't going to be Coach O. So, Bo Pelini it is.
Brad Edwards with us, and I think once you get Bo's system down, it's effective. Now you got to have the talent to run it, but you've seen it at its optimum with 09 and Sue and company. I mean, that's it's as good as it's going to get, right, with the Pelini D, and you've got some NFL dudes running it for you, but it was too tough this year. 35 points a game. Pelini's contract was a guaranteed 3 years, so Bo's getting paid $7
million. Yeah.
Bo's collecting a lot of money.
Good gig if you can get it.
I know. Let's flip gears and talk about the college football playoff. And do you think the committee got it right? Do you like the final four we have? And if so, wonderful. If there's a Brad Edwards adjustment, what would it be? What team do you think had the best argument to maybe find their way into that fourth spot?
Well, for starters, I think the top three were a no-brainer. I know some people were not happy with Ohio State being at three, but to me, that one was pretty easy. You know, for number four, I didn't like the choice of Notre Dame, but you have to ask the question that we often ask on basketball selection. When a team gets in that you think shouldn't have gotten in, actually, it usually works in reverse in basketball. In basketball, it's usually this team should have gotten in, right? Mm-hmm. Like, they got a raw deal. But then the follow-up is, okay, well, who should they have been in place of? You have to take someone out. In this case, you had to put someone in. Like, there has to be a fourth team. And while I don't think Notre Dame was deserving of it after what happened to them on Saturday, I can't sit here and say that I could make a much better case for Texas A&M or Oklahoma or Cincinnati. I know a lot of people wanted to see Cincinnati, but to me, if the committee is going to tell us that it's the four best and not the four most deserving, if it's four most deserving, Cincinnati, go ahead. I mean, they're the only ones that didn't play themselves out.
Right.
But if it's four best, I just have a hard time, not just because of the schedule overall, but even the very last game, the closing argument. You kick a field goal in the final play to beat Tulsa. I mean, there's nothing about that that suggests that you're one of the four best teams. So, you know, you take your pick, and they took Notre Dame, and I'm not expecting a competitive semifinal, but here's the truth. Very few of the semis through the first 6 years have been competitive.
They are blowouts, most of them. I mean, you had Ohio State, Clemson last year. That's chippy. You have Ohio State that's not apologizing. You have Clemson and Dabo's coaches poll that puts Ohio State at number 11. That's great. And Ohio State doesn't like how things ended last year. And they were on the ropes against Northwestern, and then Ohio State decided to run the football. You know, novel concept. We've been talking about that for 2 hours here. Look what happens when you run the football. But how do you see that shaking out as we kind of preview it a little bit here? Is this going to be tight, or do you think Clemson's just too dominant, too superior to Ohio State?
I think in a normal season, it would have been another really good game like it was last year. But because it's not a normal season, I think, look, as much has been made about Ohio State having this advantage by, you know, not having to play as many games and, you know, apparently the committee's giving them a break and, you know, all the reasons that people want to argue against them. I think when you get on the other side of the selection now, that is not a benefit to Ohio State because they have, look, this is going to be game number 7 for them. There are a lot of teams that are still trying to get things figured out at game 7 in a normal season. And this is a team that has not figured it out. You know, that the lack of continuity, I mean, they went out and they played the first 3 weekends of the Big Ten schedule, and they have not played in consecutive weekends since then. And I think it just affects your ability to get better, to go out there and continue to get reps and to improve upon the things that you need to improve on. And that's why you look at them on both sides of the ball and you're like, you know what? I mean, you know their talent is better than what you see on the field. But this late in the season, what realistic argument could you make for why they would all of a sudden play up to their potential on January 1st? Like, it's just, you haven't seen anything building. It would be completely out of left field for them to do that. And so between the way that they played against Northwestern and the way that Clemson played against Notre Dame, it just seems to me Clemson is just a lot further along as a team, you know, having developed this season than Ohio State. And for that reason, I think Ohio State would have to be. It's going to take a huge effort from Justin Fields, who we don't even know for sure what the status is of his thumb injury that was very clearly bothering him at the end of that game. And with only a 13-day turnaround, isn't the usual 4 weeks, you know, between conference championships and semifinals. So less time for that to heal. I just have a hard time seeing Ohio State play as well as they'll need to beat Clemson. And it's not really their fault. It's just 2020 in the hand they were dealt.
Brad Edwards with us, ESPN Insider College Game Day College Football Analyst at @JBradEdwards on Twitter. Where should Indiana be? They're in the Outback Bowl against Ole Miss. That's kind of a homecoming there for Coach Allen, was an assistant at Ole Miss. But Ole Miss and Indiana are in the Outback Bowl. You have Oregon and Iowa State in the Fiesta. You also have Georgia and Cincinnati in the Peach Bowl. You've got some at Indiana irate at the Big Ten for not campaigning for IU. Another shot at Commissioner Warren. Where would you, if you were selecting Indiana, who would you have matched them up with?
Well, who was the team immediately ahead of Indiana in the rankings? I'm trying to think who got into a New Year's Six game ahead of them.
Georgia and Cincinnati both got in the New Year's Six in the Peach Bowl. Okay, you've got the Fiesta Bowl, and that has Iowa State and Oregon. All right, and then you got A&M and Carolina in the Orange Bowl.
Okay, yeah, I mean for me, Iowa State is the team that I would take out.
Okay.
You know, that, and I understand what the committee's doing, which is that they don't penalize teams for losing a conference championship game. And Iowa State played well enough in that game to have a chance to win. And they certainly didn't embarrass themselves, you know, and they are a really good team. But I look at what Indiana did, and for them to not get a chance to play in that game and getting passed over by a team with 3 losses and you know, one of them is to a Sun Belt team, and it's a ranked Sun Belt team, sure. But that one I think would be the hardest one for me to take if I'm Indiana, is that they put Iowa State in. Now, do I think Indiana's better than Iowa State? Not necessarily, and certainly without Penix,
Sure.
It's a tougher argument to make, and maybe the committee took that into account, which is that we've only seen him play one game without him, and offensively there wasn't much there. So I don't know, but I hate it for them. It's not so much that I think, you know, we should deny Iowa State the chance. I think they deserve the chance to be in a game like this, and it's great for them. But I think Indiana deserved it too, and maybe more than anything, I just wish there were more spots. But you know what I wish? I wish they were. The correct answer is they should be in there instead of Oregon, right?
Yeah, that's the answer.
The system is set up where the conference champion automatically gets in, which is why I didn't go to Oregon first. But yeah, that's where the problem is. It's not Iowa State. It's that Oregon is getting into one of these games ahead of Indiana. But outside of that, I think Indiana should have gone to whatever the next best bowl was for the Big Ten. And end of the day, I mean, they're playing Ole Miss, and it's an Ole Miss team that has a really good offense, even without its two best targets in the passing game, mm-hmm. who both decided not to play last week. And so I think that offense against the Indiana defense is a great matchup. And even though, you know, Indiana's offense is not what it was because of the change of quarterback, Ole Miss's defense is horrible. So I think it sets up to be a good matchup as far as strength on weakness. Yeah, exactly. I mean, whoever has the ball, it's strength on weakness.
Brad Edwards with us here on ESPN, Hail Varsity Radio. Brad, only about 30 seconds left here, so I got to ask you, college football playoff, is Alabama the team to beat?
I think they're the team to beat, and I think Clemson is the only team that can beat them. I would hesitate to read too much into what happened to their defense against Florida. Not that their defense is great, but nobody else in the country has a player like Kyle Pitts that can cause you to have to change so much of what you want to do. So I don't think you're going to see Notre Dame run up a huge number on Alabama.
Brad, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays. Thanks for jumping on with us today, and best to you and your family this week.
Okay, same to everyone out there. Merry Christmas.
Thanks. Take care. Brad Edwards with us, ESPN Insider, College Game Day. Good stuff. So we went a little national, and we'll have a little bit more on Bo Pelini, dismissed from LSU. Hail Varsity Radio continues.
And now, back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Back with you, Hail Varsity Radio, Hail Varsity Magazine. The best of Hail Varsity continues, and we have to include one of our favorites. That is Clausebourne. He's imaginary. He wears red, and he participated in a spelling bee, the first annual Hail Varsity Spelling Bee. Jay Moore, TJ Henning, myself, we were all judges. Brandon Vogel, one of the smartest dudes around of Hail Varsity, versus Clausebourne. Enjoy. So Jay Moore is a judge in the first annual Hail Varsity Spelling Bee, as is TJ Henning, as am I. And we welcome in Brandon L. Vogel of HailVarsity.com and Magazine. Vogues, what are your credentials again?
My credentials are that I placed in some Box Butte County Spelling Bee that I can no longer remember, but it was probably second, third, fourth grade, somewhere around there.
That was impressive. Clausebourne, how are you, sir?
Well, I'm doing okay. I feel a little ambushed, but as long as we don't have more than two syllables, I suppose I'll be okay.
Okay, that'll work. And you're not ambushed. Clausebourne, you're pretty bright. You're well-read, aren't you?
Well, I do come from a family of learned doctors.
There we go. We got a little music here. Okay, the first word goes to Brandon L. Vogel. Football.
Football. Country of origin, please.
America.
Okay. Football. F-O-O-T-B-A-L-L. Football.
Judges.
That's correct.
Okay, good work.
I'd like to raise a point of contention. The country of origin for football is America.
Okay, thank you.
Try to pronounce it correctly so there's no confusion.
Thank you, Clausebourne. Clausebourne, fumble rooski.
Okay. Can you use it in a sentence?
Dean Steinkuhler scored on a fumble rooski in the 84 Orange Bowl. Will Shields ran it against Colorado in 1992.
Fumble rooski. F U N B L E R O O S K I.
That is correct. That is correct.
Well, correct.
All right. Well done. Vogel. Switzer.
Switzer. Okay. Let's see. S W I T Z E R.
That's correct.
That is correct. Okay. Clausebourne. Missouri.
Somehow I knew this was going to come up, and I would have been disappointed had it not. M I. Let's see, and now I'm confused. Does it go Z or S? Let me start again. M I S S O U R A. Missouri.
We're going to take that.
That sounds good.
It's 2-2. Okay. Vogues, this is tough.
Punt. I'll do my best.
Punt.
I can't punt this one. I got to take it.
Yes.
All right. Punt. P-U-N-T. Punt.
Any more brain busters?
All right. Clausebourne. Kamani Fred.
K H I M A N I.
No. Clausebourne. Of course.
Well, no one watches basketball. What are you talking about?
Kamani Friend is spelled K-I-M-A-N-I. Friend, F-F-R-I-E-N-D. One strike.
I got the first name right. That's close enough.
Clausebourne, don't argue with
me. Hey, that's ridiculous.
Okay. Vogues?
Dadgummit.
Okay. Vogue's Riola.
Riola. I'm interested in the country of origin for this one as well, but I'll just go.
America. Hawaii.
Yeah, that's a key distinction. All right. R-A-I-O-L-I-A.
Oh, Vogues!
So close.
R-A-I-O-L-A. So we each have a strike here. It's okay.
I believe Riola is also an affordable family sedan from Japan, so just trying to...
Wow. Clausebourne, you're up.
Okay.
Gonorrhea.
C A R L. Is that wrong?
That is incorrect. Oh. Two okay. Strikes. Two strikes.
Oh my gosh.
Vogues. Spell flag.
Flag. Okay. F L A G. Flag.
That is correct. Clausebourne, you need to get this to keep it. Keep it rolling here. Are you okay?
I'm okay.
Okay. Tone Ufinotti.
You give him all the easy ones. T O and I really don't think you need any more letters than that. T-O-N-I-U.
Ooh, correct on the first part.
S-O-N-O-T-I.
He got it. We are tied. We are out of time. We are going to hold this over for the next segment. Each will have one word.
One word left.
Mm-hmm. Sudden death. Clausebourne, I'm impressed. You got Tony Finotti correct. In votes?
I blacked out. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. Well played. And, man, Clausebourne missed on Kamani Friend. And Vogues, you missed on
Rayola.
And Clausebourne, we're going to leave the Carl one alone.
Too bad we won't get to hear the end of that spelling bee, unfortunately. Clausebourne versus Vogel, the greatest matchup of all time. Coming up next segment, we are going to hear from Bob Diaco. It is Bob's greatest hits. Back when Nebraska beat Purdue, Bob Diaco, of course, the defensive coordinator there. It is a Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition, and we are presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
Miss us?
Come here, brother. Give me a hug. Bring it in for the real thing.
We're on call for you. Catch the podcast at HailVarsity.com, the ESPN Lincoln app, or download them on iTunes.
Saddle up, partner.
Back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Welcome back to Hail Varsity Radio Best of Edition. I'm Damon Barr. I've been hosting it through today's show. We have one last stop here, and that is Bob Diaco's Greatest Hits. Enjoy.
I will remember you.
Bob's first presser. Come on down.
Will you remember me?
Love what I do. Love what I do. I love football. I don't need to read some kind of motivational quote to get out of bed every morning. I mean, I am on fire when my feet hit the floor. I operate that way. Try to, I'd say the style is very intense, very detailed, but we're positive. We don't tear people down. There's no profanity in the teaching. There's no emasculating in the teaching. It's uplifting.
There is profanity in the stands. There is emasculation in the stands. More from Disco Bob on the College Football Hall of Fame career of Josh Kalu.
In my mind, there's no doubt that he is and or will be one of the best safeties in the country, if not the very best safety in the country.
Joshua thanks you. He is killing it for Tennessee. Love me some Kalu. Baloo's Kalu's. Best defense in the country. Can I have that for 100, Bob?
There is no doubt that we are going to create a great defense. We are going to create the best defense in the country here. There's no doubt about that. It's just going to take time, and the players are good enough to do just that.
Let's talk mic etiquette. That can go on your shirt, Bob.
I had no idea till we went to our tackling drill on the first full padded practice of spring football and found that the players were spectacularly frustrated during the drill because they're willing, they're talented enough to tackle, they're tough enough to tackle, they're willing tacklers, they want to do well. But they don't fundamentally know anymore how to tackle at all.
How did this even happen? Did I-Course tell Riley that I have found your stash of Werther's and I'm going to throw them away if you don't take this guy on as your defensive coordinator? Oh, and by the way, fire your bro banker over the phone. Diaco's not a runner.
Contrary to at least what was depicted, I've never run away from anything in my life. I've never not stood up and been accountable and responsible to my work and what I'm been entrusted to do. That's never happened. To be painted in that light or that way is just absolutely ridiculous.
Okay, so he's not into painting. He's not into running. This, the money shot, the strain.
There's no reasonable reason, considering where the defensive program was at, to believe that they should be able to do everything that needs to be done in the game to win the game. The strain is spectacular, right? So we can just go back and look at the game. Then you see, do you see the strain? I mean, do you see it or no? Or is it just something that I'm missing? Right? You can't play a game like that and win. Right?
Thank you, Bob. Well, that'll do it for Hail Varsity Radio Best Of. We're presented by the Nebraska Lottery.